very difficult budget year because rhetoric is good for speeches, but it certainly is not good for making budgets and doing the right thing for the taxpayers of the state of New York.
Senator John DeFrancisco is your voice during this budget process. Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandy with the Deputy Majority Leader today. Hi, Senator.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing fine.
You know, it has been a busy week. There's movement on the confirmation of the state's top judge. The first budget hearing was yesterday. That was on transportation and the third week of session. Explain your role in all of these.
Well, I have a role in all of them in some respects. As far as the governor's release of the budget, I immediately made my comments concerning that. Concerning the budget hearings, I'm not chair any longer. Mm-hmm. However, that doesn't preclude me from being in the at the hearings asking questions, and it depends on what else is going on, whether I can make it or not. And lastly, I was at the confirmation hearing before the Judiciary Committee yesterday of Judge DeFiore, District Attorney DeFiore. She's been all those things, which shows that she's well qualified. And that's going to be voted on by the full Senate today. So, yes, it has been busy. And what's very good about it, I think, is it shows that rather than the first few sessions days in Albany, when usually it's more ceremonial and things aren't really moving,
right,
this is good to get the early start.
Yes. So last week you voted in favor of term limits for leadership.
Well, the Senate has done it in their rules, required leadership term limits. In other words, John Flanagan became majority leader last year. He will have a total of 8 years or four terms to become a leader. One of the criticisms, and we had this well before Shelley Silver had his difficulties that resulted in his conviction, and the thought is that if you are in the most important leadership position with so much power, that it should turn over at least every 8 years. And the Assembly has no such rule in the Assembly. And, you know, whether a turnover would have made a difference as far as the aggregation of power that he developed over the years, Sheldon Silver, but it's there in the Senate rules. So the Assembly didn't do it, so we passed a bill making it a law for that to happen. And hopefully the Assembly will pass it as well. And at that point, it would have to go before the voters after two passages in the Senate and the Assembly, and that would be the rule.
All right, so you just basically set up a clip we have from session, because you were responding to a senator who was in opposition of the bill, citing that there is already a rule in the Senate and the Assembly has not passed this yet.
Well, it is in the Senate rules now, but a law has much more substantial of effect. You have to have the bill changed and the law changed subsequently if it becomes law, and you have to have the governor to sign it. Maybe the governor wouldn't sign a repeal. This is much stronger, and we have passed it in the past. That because the Assembly hasn't passed it as well, that means we shouldn't. That doesn't make any sense as far as I'm concerned. We should do it. There's many instances where the Assembly decides to follow one of our bills in the future, and we should do it. And obviously, the power in both legislative bodies is concentrated on leadership. I think this is an excellent reform measure, and we should all support it.
And it's not only for the Senate Majority Leader and the Speaker of the House, but it would be for all committee chairmanship, mm-hmm, as well as other leadership positions. So it's a turnover in roles, and I think limiting the concentration of power that's in existence right now.
A step in reform, which people are calling for.
I think it's a good step.
Mm-hmm. So another measure to give taxpayers a responsible government. How do you rein in spending?
Well, the governor has said, and accurately so, that we have imposed upon our local governments and school districts that they cannot increase spending by more than 2% or the cost of inflation, which is a lot lower now. And the state has voluntarily, and I emphasize voluntarily, followed that rule for our budgets over the last 5 years. Now, that's great that it's a voluntary thing that we've done. However, once again, if we've got a law for the counties and the municipalities and other municipalities and school districts to keep spending under 2%, why shouldn't we have a law as well requiring the same thing rather than at the whim of the legislature and the governor? We could break that cap and spending goes up. Our problem over the last several years, especially since 2009, 2010, was overspending. And why get into that problem again when we've been having on-time balanced budgets for the last 5 years?
So as we said, the transportation hearing is the first budget hearing. And when I caught up with you after the governor's budget address, you were again concerned with regional balance. Let's take a listen.
If you add up everything between the Tappan Zee Bridge, the Penn Station, the LaGuardia Airport, and God knows what else, and you compare that to $22 billion for upstate transportation, it's honest to God, it is completely impossible to do, to say that's parity, unless the governor is changing the definition of parity.
Obviously, I was jacked up right after the governor's speech, because there was just more than any speech I've seen. I've been here, this is my 24th year. It had more rhetoric. It sounded like a campaign speech, and short on details on everything. Yeah. It just showed how he was going to do everything for everybody this year, and we all know that's not possible. So what we're doing now, that sets the stage for budget hearings, mm-hmm. for conference committees with the Senate and the Assembly to try to get the details so that we could recommend changes or recommend more specificity in what the governor is looking for. So it's not the end of the process, it's just the beginning, but still it would have been much more helpful if we got more details. Right. And the other thing, he did the budget presentation and the State of the State at the same time. When they were separated by all other governors, the budget presentation was much more detailed. And then after the governor gives that general outline, the head of the budget director of the state of New York, would answer questions mm-hmm. and make specific comments. So it got us much further along in the process by that specificity. So this was not a system that should be continued. I hope the governor doesn't decide to do it again.
All right, so let's take a look at next week's hearings. We will find out a lot more information there, hopefully. The 25th, health and Medicaid, 26th, local and general government issues, 27th, elementary and secondary education, and the 28th, environmental conservation.
And the viewers or all the citizens can watch these.
Yes.
They're live online mm-hmm.
Senate website, Channel 83.
Channel 83.
And their archive, too.
Correct. You got two routes. So either through your computer, on this, go to the Senate website, or Channel 83 in Syracuse.
All right. So before the governor outlined his plan, the Senate already took action on education. Talk about what you are thinking about for schools.
All right. The governor, here's a perfect example. He said we're going to increase school spending by $2.1 billion. You know, I was kind of taken aback because that's a huge number. Until later on, we find out that's over 2 years. And it's a little bit misleading when you're giving a budget presentation for this year for that to be over a two-year period. So it wasn't as magnanimous as it sounded during the speech. But one of the most onerous provisions of that things that have happened in the past. I mentioned 2009, 2010. That's when the New York City Democrats controlled the Senate, the Assembly, and the governor was also from New York City. And we increased spending by $10 billion and taxes by $10 billion. One of the gimmicks that was done at that point is they put a special layer on the education formula. Since there's a gap in funding, we're going to eliminate the gap elimination adjustment, we're going to make an adjustment. So what it did was take away dollars from various school districts away from the general formula. So we've been pecking away at getting rid of that taking away of funds for the districts and we're about two-thirds there. And we have pledged in our discussions, even before the governor provided his budget presentation, to get totally rid of it now, because it's unfair to districts to have a special fund that only takes dollars away from certain school districts. And in some districts, it's in the millions. And so we're hopefully going to stick to that gun, those guns. John Flanagan, who's now our leader, so that's a line in the sand. Hopefully, that's exactly what happens.
And the investment tax credit as well.
The investment tax credit for schools is basically a way for people that want to support private schools can get a tax credit against their taxes. And but it also applies as a pot of money both for the private schools and public schools. So if you're someone who wants to support the public school that your children are at, you can make a tax contribution, and there's a tax credit comes right off of your taxes. The amount is limited. I forgot the exact number that it's limited to, but we've been trying to get this done for years. The opponents say, well, it should only be for public schools. Private schools are, you know, you can, it's your own choice whether you go to private schools. The fact of the matter, if private schools were not around, the cost to the state education for education funds would be absolutely astronomical. They're taking away a huge obligation that the state has to educate our children. And if people want to, whether high income or low income, go to a Catholic school or another denomination school or a private school, since they're being taxed for their schools, for schools sending your kids, give them a credit for providing for the funding that is taken, that is not have to be funded by the state of New York any longer.
So I want to go back now to your first reaction out of the doors of the State of the State message. You know, you spoke about what needs to be considered in order to reverse the trend of losing population and jobs.
We can show temporary progress in our job numbers, but overall, if we're losing people and losing businesses, you can't keep heaping on businesses more expenses. Minimum wage, paid family leave, other burdens, regulatory burdens, you just can't do that. And so one side of the presentation doesn't match with what he's proposing on the other side of the presentation.
And, you know, the governor was had many different proposals, whether it's the increase of the minimum wage, paid family leave, all kinds of proposals that sound good, but there's a corresponding effect of all of that. The more things that are imposed upon businesses, the more likely jobs are not going to be kept. We've talked about the 15 per hour minimum wage for fast food restaurants. There's already restaurants in other areas that have imposed that have put kiosks in the front lobby, and people are not working anymore because it made the cost for these organizations would not justify keeping people. And it's just effectively, I met this morning with a group of people on the other end of the spectrum that are helping young kids in foster care. And they are reimbursed some monies to help pay for their employees. However, if the minimum wage goes into effect across the board, theirs is going to come up, and they haven't had a raise from the state to help provide these services for 17 years, or 7 years. There's been a freeze. So you can't just say we're going to give without some problem on the other end. And the proof of the pudding in my mind is we lose Congress members every 10 years when the census takes place because we're losing population in relation to other states. Mm-hmm. And the more we lose the population, the less the tax base is, and the bigger the hole we're driving. So rather than just saying we want to do all things for all people, these things have to be looked carefully at so that you're not causing a further erosion of the population of the state.
Right. So this will come into play week by week, and you will come back to give us the breakdown, right?
I will, and it's going to be, I think, a very contentious budget year. I really do, because there's so many different issues that are still out there that where there's disagreement. But somehow the last 5 years we came together on time, and hopefully that'll happen again.
Yes. Thank you so much for your time, Senator.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information on what we discussed today, defrancisco.nysenate.gov.